Welcome to the checkpoint. I am Vivian Kamsimi. On 31st of July 1993, His Majesty Ronald Muwenda Mutebi was crowned as the 36th Kabaka of Buganda. And this was 27 years after the deposition and exiling of his father, Sekabaka Mutesa II, who had been removed by Obote I government in 1966. When the NRM came to power in 1986, Buganda elders started pushing for the restoration of kingdoms and enthronement of the Kabaka. Subsequently, in 1993, the Restoration of Assets and Properties Act of 1993 was passed and the Kabakaship was restored. This week, 30 years down the road, we look back to that path that got the traditional institutions back. And what kind of journey have they walked? With me is veteran journalist John Kakande to speak to us about this. You're welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I am very delighted to have you on the show because of two things. Number one, you are an expert in the media.
Thank you.
And having been there, you held certain positions that got you to witness firsthand some of the key events in Buganda Kingdom, but also that Buganda, arguably being the most important kingdom in our modern day formation, has got a lot of impact on us as Uganda.
Some other people would you question that statement?
Exactly, that's why I said arguably. To what extent do you agree with that?
Yeah, the kingdom, first of all, is at the center of the country, the central position. The location itself gives it a leverage over the others, be it as a huge population, much bigger than any other kingdom we talk about. Some people say it was favored by the British. I'm not so sure about that. But also it has gone through a lot of hardship because it has been at the center where the political conflicts really play out a lot. So yes, it's quite an important kingdom as far as this country is concerned. Some people believe that a lot of the instability in the country has been caused by the Buganda question, the unresolved Buganda question. What should be the status of Buganda Kingdom in an independent country? You know? So, from time to time, that issue comes up. And there are times causes tension.
Well, as things are now, do we even still have the Buganda question? But before we dig into all that, because that's what we are going to be talking about.
Yeah.
John, where were you when the Kabaka was coronated in 1993?
I was already working as a journalist. I was working for a private media house then at that time, which is now defunct. We are publishing a Uganda paper called Ingabo, which was a pro-monarch newspaper because the head of the publisher himself is a Kilani leader for the Rugave. But I was working mainly for the English edition, which was called the Star. So we are the center of because, as I said, the publishing house was a pro-monarch media house. So a lot of things even before the Kabaka came back and he was in Nairobi, our publisher, who was also a veteran journalist, traveled to Nairobi and had an interview with him. The paper actually was crusading for the restoration of the monarch. So I didn't go, I was a senior person at that time. I was already an editor. So I didn't go to Nagalavi, but we were handling the content as it was coming through. Mm. Yeah.
John, having been, you know, an eyewitness of this coronation, having pushed for it to actually happen, and seeing it being achieved, and it has now been exercised all these years, 30 whooping years to talk about, what are the hits and misses of the Kabaka ship, otherwise called the Mengo leadership?
First of all, I think the restoration of the traditional institutions, as they called in the law, was a major development, which came after a lot of argument and discussion and the debate. I believe at first it was not the intention of the government to restore the institutions. Yes, when the Kabaka came back, the question then was, how do you refer to him? Subsequently, I think internally within the government, they agreed that he should be referred to as Sabataka. Sabataka would imply the head of the Bataka, the clan leaders in Uganda. That was the first step. And you may be surprised that when he returned at that time, Radio Uganda, which was a government media house, wouldn't refer to him. They simply referred to him as Prince. It was so uncertain. How would you deal with him? We didn't call him Kabaka because Kabaka, the kingdom, had been scrapped. So finally, after some time, I think there are people internally who also were opposed to even calling him Sabataka. Now, subsequently, to cut the whole story short, I think what helped, there was a bit of reluctance. I think what helped was that by 93, you'd wonder why, because the government comes in 86. And the Kabaka subsequently returns. And when he returns, of course, finally, it was agreed more or less informally that he's called the Sabataka. Him and his advisors then start reconstructing the institution. Remember, as we said, for over two decades, the institution had been crushed. It had been abolished. The Baganda continued to have their clans, and the clans continued to function. But the Kabaka is supposed to be the head of all of them. So they apparently had been decapitated because the Kabaka was not there. The clan leaders were there. So when he returns, I think the first thing he does is, how do you reconstitute the institution? But what you will note that the coronation comes in 93. Why 93? Because the country was going into the CA elections in 94. And the Baganda loyalists were getting agitated that the government had not allowed the restoration of the kingdom. So, side by side, there were people who were agitating for the return of the political parties. You know? They were also agitating because NRM had come, 4 years had passed, there had been an extension. The earlier understanding was that after 4 years, we shall go back to multi-party politics, which did not happen. There was an extension of the administration, of the movement administration. So now these two forces were emerging. The agitators for multi-party politics and the agitators for the kingdom. And it looked like they are going to merge and then create pause and opposition to the NRM administration. So in my analysis, the government says understood what was coming up, and they decided to make a concession to return the kingdom to separate the two forces. And this was a decision taken, as you know, by the Army Council as an organ. It's not something which was brought to in the parliament that we debate. Should we have kingdoms back or not? It was the military with their commander-in-chief and chairman of the high command. I think they discussed the matter. A handful of them opposed. I think the majority were convinced. That's it. So the country was informed. One of the clan leaders was summoned to Guru. He's still alive, Nnamdi Kibale, who had also been an active member of the UPM party in 1980. So he was given the resolution, a copy of the resolution, say, look, as far as you're concerned, then Parliament moved very fast and they enacted the act allowing the restoration. Then the coronation came up. What I can say is that the real move to restore the institutions, these institutions was a major movement, a major decision, because even internally within the NRM, there are people who are opposed. And I think that explains why in Ankole they have not restored the king, because there are voices from that region who were vehemently opposed, and I think they remain opposed to up to now. B, then the king, who is the Kabaka after he was crowned, I think all these years he has been trying to reconstitute the institution. Mind you that what was restored was not exactly what had been abolished. Mm-hmm. Because by 1966, Buganda was a federal state within the country. So what some people call a state within a state. Now, care has been taken, or the understanding what actually the NRM agreed to was not to restore the kingdom as a state. You get the point?
Yes.
But to restore the institution of the Kabakaship.
And that brings me to something here. There were some voices that said that this restoration, which you're now talking about, a restoration of the institution, and not what was there in 1966, when Obote I government abolished kingdoms. This, for some people, is hot air, or they were calling it ebio ya byanswa. Is that what you're trying to refer to?
You see the... What existed at that time was that Uganda had a government. It had a parliament. That parliament would make laws. That government could raise taxes, just like any other government. Now, what exists now is that there is the king, there is the Kabaka, as the institution. Whatever exists now exists as part of that institution of the Kabakaship. What they are talking about now, And what the Kabaka himself mentioned yesterday was that they want the restoration of the state of Buganda. It's when you say you want federalism, you are simply saying we want an arrangement, governance, where there are autonomous states existing and coming together at the top, just like you have the US, you have the federal government, and you have state governments. That would mean if you have a government in Mengo, that government will be allowed to raise some taxes. Could be it could also be in charge of its own police. Could be it could also be running some of the hospitals.
Making some loans.
Yes.
I just want to take you back a little when you were explaining to us that relationship of how there were two voices that were agitating for different things, the ones agitating for kingdoms and the ones that wanted parties. To what extent do you think that the restoration of this Kabakaship made the NRM and President Museveni popular here? Because at some point we saw the president earlier then donning the kanzu, and even the first lady got to wear gomesi. Yeah.
For the ordinary Muganda in Nakaseke, where the president prostituted the war, that ordinary Muganda has no distinction between the kingdom, when they say Buganda kingdom today, and the Buganda kingdom in 1966. For him or her, it is the same. The same thing. It is for elite
what?
Who say, no. What you have restored is not exactly what existed. Mm. Probably this is halfway. That's why there is still that agitation. That's why they still talk about a halfway. Because there are certain things that the previous kingdom government could do, which now you have the Rukiko here, but that Rukiko has no powers to make laws. They say you wouldn't call it a parliament. I see at times in the media people call it a parliament. I think the proper word would be to call it an assembly or a council, because it is not a legislative body that has the mandate to make laws, even for the region. Actually, right now, the Uchiko is simply to help to support the Kabaka to run the institution, and it derives its legality from the institution of the Kabaka. And the Kabaka can fight, can disband it, can do anything he wants. That was not the case by 66, because it existed by law, not everybody in the Chico was handpicked by the Kabaka. It had become more democratic, and it was also charged with electing the Katikiro. Joseph Manjankang, who was the Katikiro at the time of the crisis, 66, had been elected as the Kabaka could influence through other maneuvers, just like the president can influence the election of the mayor in the city here, but the president cannot appoint the mayor. Mm. In the same way, the Kabaka could influence the election of the Katikiro, but he could not handpick and put him there. So it you see, the restoration of the kingdom or the traditional leaders was a popular move, and I think the president understood it, especially for the rural communities where he derived a lot of his support. They're extremely happy. I think up to now, many people are still happy with that. But for the more sophisticated, they can understand that, okay, it was a good move, but is he going to move further? Is he going to give any more concessions? It looks like on the political front, he hasn't since that time.
You see, when you talk about the political front and the elite and how it actually gets to impact the kingdom, I am thinking of some of the things that actually got it restored. For example, the restored Kabaka was barred from partisan politics.
Yeah.
Under the law that brought back that those kingdoms.
Yes.
Has this weakened or has it strengthened the kingdom over the last 30 years? For the kingdom?
I think the dominant view is in favor of the Kabaka not to get directly engaged in the partisan politics.
Mm.
And I think the Kabaka has done well to ensure that there is a lot of temptation, because we have seen some traditional leaders in this country who have openly supported, especially the ruling party. Some have become hostile to the ruling party, and they also have ended up in a hot soup. I don't want to mention some here, but there are those who have become hostile to the ruling party, and they have paid a price. The Kabaka has, and I think he has succeeded to some extent, tried to avoid getting into the fray. You don't see him during the campaign period attending rallies, you know, and he has tried very, very hard to ensure that people who hold the responsibilities in Mengo don't engage directly. You can't stop people from engaging indirectly, covertly, but openly. At least they have not come out to say we support this party.
The endorsements of candidates.
Yes, which I think is not a very simple thing, but it has helped, because I think the Kabaka must have understood very well what led to the crisis in 1966. And that crisis had been predicted by Archbishop Chwanuka, who was in Rubaga, who wrote in 61, I think that was 61, advising the Kabaka then, Mutebi's father, that please, you should stay clear of the partisan politics. Mm. You should be above it. That was at the time when Kabaka had been formed. Unfortunately, they didn't take heed of the Archbishop. He wrote a pastoral letter, and they didn't take heed of his advice, and subsequently he was proved right.
Okay.
So I think the Kabaka Mutebi comes in having understood some of the factors. There was a lot of animosity in Uganda after the parties were introduced, between the Anglican and the Catholic. You see? I think the Kabaka has tried and has so far succeeded to ensure that he brings in his administration people of different faith. You have seen after Mayanja Nkangi, his first appointment as a caretaker was a Catholic, Mwanyamwe Semogere. I believe that was deliberate. It was not by accident. How do you ensure that you bridge the rift that existed before? The current caretaker is also a Catholic. There's been Anglicans.
J.B. Walusimbi.
J.B. Walusimbi, Danny Morika was there. those were Anglicans.
And actually, today when they released the structure,
but you know, of the previously cabinet, the position of since the colonial days, the position of the cathedral had been ring fenced for Anglicans.
Okay.
And that caused a lot of animosity. And some people believe it is one of the factors that contributed to the formation of the Democratic Party, because some of the of the people who were active in the Democratic Party felt that they had been marginalized in the Uganda Kingdom. So I think the Kabaka has done well to understand the lessons from history. And he is trying to steer the kingdom, avoiding the pitfalls that his father faced, and that led to the abolition of the kingdoms. That's not to say that he hasn't had challenges. As you know, there was the Kayunga riots.
Just before we get to the Kayunga riots, of course, the cabinet list that the Katikkiro just put out shows that his deputies are Muslims.
Yes.
Like Owechi Twaha.
And I think that is intentional.
Yes, Twaha.
Intentional to appease. Although I know the Muslims are also looking forward to a day when the Katikkiro will be a Muslim.
A Muslim. Okay.
Just as the many Catholics believe, they want to see the day when a Catholic will be president of Uganda.
let's talk about the regional tire system.
Yes.
That was brought by Professor Nsibambi and was then rejected by the kingdom. Do you think it was a mistake for Mengo to have rejected it?
First of all, it has not been adopted by any region. So it's hard to tell whether it was going to be a good thing or it's going to be a bad thing. I think the regional tier system was brought in as a fallback position. The government is in the Constituent Assembly. Buganda worked very hard, the kingdom, Buganda Kingdom. You know, the Sabalangira was a member of the CA, Beswari Murondo. So they are not able to convince the NRM, the movement, as they were, but they were able to convince the opposition, the Maid Party proponents to join hands. Unfortunately, it was knocked down. The motion to establish a federal system was knocked down. Now, as a way of appeasing, especially Buganda, the concept of regional tier was brought in. And it and the constitution says the districts of Buganda, except Kampala, were deemed to have agreed to form a regional tier. Subsequently, there were discussions, negotiations between the government side and the kingdom side, and some argument was reached. But afterwards, Buganda Kingdom rejected the whole concept. Said no, either you give us the federal we know, or you don't.
Just
why I think the issues that came up was that you see, under decentralization, it was claimed that power was decentralized to the district. Even that issue of regional tier, the anchor were the districts. They could opt to join or opt out if they felt that their interests are not well taken care of. But also some powers had already been decentralized, so to say. Like the district land board, you're in charge of the land already. Now, the regional tier did not envisage recalling those powers from the district to the region. That was one short for. B, of course, it meant that a district could also exit. Some people feared that it could be districts like Nakasongola or Zimbabwe or the Antonde could easily walk out of the whole thing. Then where, and worse still, they could opt out and join another regional tier. What would you do?
Like maybe Bunyoro or something.
Yes, yes, yes. So there was suspicion that A, is the government doing this thing in good faith? Or it's just a deception. You see? That could government use it actually to dismember Buganda region? Buganda as an entity.
Look, Buganda had come to the table with their FEDEL.
Yes.
And government was here saying, we can't give you this much,
yes,
but we can give you this less.
Take this. We can't see. Give you the whole of.
Yes.
But
so
could
this
be taken
regional system.
Half of the of.
Looked like federal.
It
what
looked
else
like
did Buganda want really? Besides those
no,
shortfalls that you're
because,
talking about.
Because, they had assigned some responsibilities. Okay? Could be the other issue that came up was because you see the whole thing, the way how it was negotiated, also tended to fuse the kingdom institution, the monarchical institution, and the regional government. I don't know whether you understand that. You see the Kabaka exists with his katikiro. He appoints the katikiro. As of now, he has his Luchiko. Now, under what was being proposed, you are going to have a fusion where, because then the katikiro will be a public officer handling public funds, would be subjected to an election through universal adult suffrage. You see? So some people interpreted it as a way of weakening the Kabaka. So if you agreed with that, then anybody can stand and be elected katikiro, even when he is not a supporter of the kingdom. Because he would say, I derive my mandate from the population that elected me. So those were some of the teething issues that were unresolved, where there was no, it looked as if an agreement had been reached. But in essence, these issues remained of concern. But also, even now, by the way, when you see, well, as the concept of decentralization was again launched in 1993, before the CA, what has happened since that time is that the central government has steadily recalled all the powers they had given to the districts. And I think that was the whole issue, fear, that you see, is there a conviction at the central government level that they should share power? I think that's the whole problem. Why federal is not being granted or accepted in this country is that I sense that the people who control power at the center are not willing to share power. Even sharing power among the institutions of state, we have seen the executive bulldozing parliament, or trying to bulldoze the judiciary. If you are not even able to let parliament operate freely, autonomously, exercising its powers, then you are very unlikely that you can accept a system of governance that distributes power to different entities And I think that's the problem.
That's a very good fact that you have pointed out, because I think without us having clarified that, then the question would have remained that why did FEDER actually fail, or why isn't it being granted? Yeah. So I think that clearly answers that question.
Yeah.
But I just want us to go to the Buganda riots of 2009, where the NRM and Mengo hostilities climaxed in Buganda. And then after that, we have seen Mengo toned down. Mm. Is it a surrender or a strategy?
I don't think it's a surrender. Let me go back. Mm. I think the...
Just briefly on that.
Briefly. Mm. You see, the two principles, if I can, I may call them, the president and the Kabaka, have had occasion to disagree, but in a more diplomatic way, not openly calling each other names. At one time, the president was complaining that the Kabaka was not picking his quarrels. You can
the
imagine
commander in chief.
You can imagine the president calling, and the other side say, "Who is calling? Ah, I don't pick his call." Mm. But it shows there was quite a bit of disagreement. Mm. And the amidst all this, of course, the misunderstanding or the disagreement started after the CA 95. Previously, the Kabaka and the president had moved on very well. First of all, the movement system as it existed also helped the Kabaka in a way, because it kept the parties in abeyance. It brought every Muganda together under one political umbrella. So the Kabaka did not have to contend with different parties. It brought the Catholics together with the Anglicans, with the Muslims, with the Pentecostals. All manner of politicians were together. So it was a good thing for the kingdom, because then your people were not split into different factions, and you didn't have to deal with different political players who were fighting each other. Now, I think the kingdom, the Kabaka and Mengo, strongly believed that through the CA they could steward FEDER for Buganda. That didn't work out. But the way it was done, even then, was the most upsetting. That you see, you have the Sabalangira, the man who does not require clearance to go to the palace, as being the one who speaks against the motion last. And you know he was the last speaker, as far as those people were pushing for FEDER were concerned. None of his colleagues knew that Beswa Mirondo, who was a prince, would talk against a motion to introduce FEDER system. So, even some of the people who had supported the motion got angry and voted against it. You get the point. So, Buganda Kingdom came out of that process very, very angry and very bitter, that people they had thought were allies had stabbed them in the back. From that time, the relationship between the Kabaka and the president got cool. When Semogele stood as the presidential candidate, a faction of people who were holding office positions in Mengo joined him openly. In fact, it was a very awkward situation. They had to be ejected. But they purported that they had the blessing of the Kabaka to support Semogele. So you understand how things were. So from that time, relationship between the the two principals wasn't good. Now, as if that was not enough, the government again also backed the establishment of the Sabanyala in Bugerere as the cultural head of the Banyala community, the Sabaruri in Bururi as the cultural head of the Bururi community. Now Mengo's interpretation of that was that the NRM government and the president remember that the Sabanyala was a soldier. He was retired actually from the army. He was a major and he was retired and he became the Sabanyala. The interpretation was that the NRM government was trying to break up and weaken the kingdom. The incident in Kayunga was over whether the Kabaka had a right to travel to Kayunga or not. Now the Sabanyala issued a threat saying, first of all, if you want to come to here, you must write to me and let me know. If you don't and you defy, you don't recognize that I am here and I am a boss here, there could be violence. So the government then said, oh, there is a likelihood that there is going to be violence in Bugerere, so the Kabaka should not go there. And then what followed is everybody's, so many people are killed.
The riots.
And many others were locked
up. CBS was closed.
CBS was
locked. But I just want to ask you, in the midst of all that, did the Buganda riots threaten the NRM government?
Yes. It was, I think it was one of the, if it was, I think the biggest explosion the government faced. And I think they had not anticipated it. They hadn't anticipated that there would be an explosion. Abrupt, sudden, everywhere.
And it did threaten the regime.
And I believe that the government must have felt must have got into panic. And probably they overreacted and used a lot of force to suppress. But from that you said has the kingdom surrendered? I believe it's a change of tactic. Strategy. Of course, you know the kingdom. Their radio was
closed.
That's where they derived a lot of money. They derived a lot of money from land. Government was also making pronouncements to do with land. That must have caused heat. The business, the land transactions badly. So I think after a prolonged time of being squeezed, it is told, I don't know now, but it was told that it was said that CBS was reopened without a license. So it's simply you operate, but we are not going to give you a license. That meant it was like. You are in Uganda. We talk about a coke belonging to the drunkard. A drunkard can come up at midnight and the order for the slaughter of the coke.
But you know, I am suffering from a sickness right now called time deficiency.
Yes.
But I just want us to talk briefly about the 1st August 2013 Memorandum of Understanding. That returned kingdom properties.
Yes.
Just briefly tell us why you think that the central government handled it this way.
It was.
Just as we close.
I think after that hostility, after that prolonged hostility from 96, relationship were strained. Now in 2013, and that was ahead of the 2016 elections, I think the president, being a very shrewd leader, felt it wise to de-escalate the tension and the conflict with Uganda, with the Kabaka. Then they came up with the MOU. I don't know whether you know the terms of the MOU. You're talking about the assets that were promised to be given back. That was not the key issue. The key issue was that both sides cease hostility against the other. That Buganda Kingdom will not do anything which was hostile to the government, and the government would also not engage in any hostility against the kingdom. Additionally, in that MOU, they said that Buganda Kingdom will not use the proceeds from the assets returned to carry out any activity against the government. In other words, the MOU somehow tied the hands of, I mean, it means that Mengo cannot sponsor a parliamentary candidate against any NRM candidate by that MOU. But also, in that MOU, they say that the assets which were Senibugerere or Burundi should be left to the local cultural leader there. So yes, there was this concession, which I'm going to give you these assets. But at the same time, say, but you also must give us this. Yeah. And from what I read, a lot of things that you were agreed on, the government has not delivered. Buganda Kingdom is still owed billions of shillings.
Because paying back about 20 billion shillings.
Now, last time I heard,
on behalf of Buganda was one of the things they are done.
When Kadaga was still speaker, I think they're talking about 200 billion. Mm. The money had accumulated.
Instead.
Even some of the properties that were returned, there was a slow process in transferring the titles.
Also, there was that issue where some of those properties were hosting government offices.
But the way I know,
and then there's a problem them being returned to Uganda when government was actually occupying them for administration.
The way I know the current president, he's a very shrewd guy. He waits until a critical moment. Say now 2026, they could return some. They could pay some of the money ahead of the elections.
Let me just conclude with this. Managing Uganda, a country with several kingdoms and tribes, is not an easy task because, like you can imagine, all these kingdoms have demands on the central government.
Yes,
but the president been able to run it with less acrimony with the traditional rulers?
A lot of them are his creation. It is him who has led. First of all, by paying salaries to these cultural leaders, it has created the inducement for all manner of communities to create their own cultural leaders. B, I think it does not differ much from what the British did here, divide and rule. I mean, now you had the Bakonjo and the Bamba as one group. Mm. Now you have two groups. Now a third group is also in the wings. Mm. You see, he's the one who is able to deal with all this. And because a lot of them exist because of the goodwill of the government, and they're happy. So you have even in places where they had never existed a cultural leader, where they had clans and their own chiefs in their own way, but never had the titles we hear now. They have come up because there is payment. The whole thing has been commercialized.
To cultural leadership. Yes. I'm very sorry, I would like to cut you short. John Kakande, senior journalist in this country, we really appreciate that you came to expound on this topic and give a wealth of knowledge.
Thank you for about the kingdom. Hosting me tonight.
Thank you. That has been this week's Checkpoint, talking about the Kingdom of Buganda and the Kabaka, who just made 30 years being coronated as the Kabaka of Buganda. Until next week, I am Vivian Kamsimi.